kailangan din natin ang mas malalim na imbestigasyon sa sabwatan ng mga inihalal nating mga opisyal ng bayan, mapa mayor, mapa congressman, mapa senador, at kahit pangulo ng ating bansa. Again, Chinese. Sa issue naman po ng korporasyon, ng pag-aari ng mga Chinese, thousands of hectares of land na pag-aari ng mga korporasyon na ang mga incorporators ay mga Chinese, yung Empire 99 Corporation, 300 titles.
Ano po ba ang trabaho ng isang resource speaker ng presidente? Pagka ho ba may maling desisyon ang presidente, will you not volunteer your legal expertise to correct the president? That for the very first time, the term online gaming was mentioned in Executive Order Number 13. When the president issued Executive Order Number 13, don't you think he legislated?
I am unable to make an opinion.
When the president issued EO Number 13, providing for the term online gaming for the very first time, don't you think, Attorney Roque, that the president legislated?
Again, Your Honor, I am unable to answer because that is not within my expertise.
Would you still deny that?
Dumami ang droga, dumami ang patayan, nagkagulo, di nagkakaisa, at sa gitna ng kanilang kaguluhan, sila ay sinakop ng mga tao sa gobyerno na inabuso ang kapangyarihan na pinagkaloob sa kanila ng mamamayan at kahit pangulo ng ating bansa at ibenta ang ating kalayaan. Yung 14K Hong Kong Triad at si Sun Yi Oh, pinakamalaking powerful drug trafficking organization in the global illegal drug market. Sila ang pinakamalaking supplier na shabu sa Pilipinas at sinabi nila na ang Pilipinas ang pinakadabes sa market at transshipment at point ng shabu dito sa ating pong rehiyon. So ito na po yung aking opening remarks and presentation. Magandang umaga po sa ating lahat. Noong nakaraang Lunes po, sa pangungula po ng ating speaker Martin Romualdez, kasama po ang ilan sa ating mga members ng committee na ito, kasama rin po si co-chair Oni Ferrer, kami po ay nagpunta sa Bamban, Tarlac, sa Porac at sa Mexico, Pampanga, kung saan nasabat ng ating mga operatiba ang mga droga na iniimbestigahan sa Committee on Dangerous Drugs sa pangunguna ni Chairman Ace Barbers. Nakita din natin ang mga lugar kung saan ang mga criminal activities were being perpetrated by perpetrators. Kasama na dyan ang lugar kung saan ang mga POGO workers na di makakota sa kanilang ginagawang scam ay pinahihirapan, tinotorture. Binisita din po namin ang mga pasilidad na nasa pangangalaga na po ng PNP at ng PAOK, TF. But sad to say that a much comprehensive approach on this must be put in place. Tama si Speaker Martin Romualdez, kailangan ng inventaryo ng mga gamit at pangangalaga ng tamang ahensya upang di masira ang mga kagamitan at pasilidad sa mga naturang lugar. Kailangan din natin ang mas malalim na investigasyon sa sabwatan ng mga inihalal nating mga opisyal ng bayan, mapa mayor, mapa congressman, mapa senador, at kahit pangulo ng ating bansa. We can see a pattern of bribery in the highest form to betray the Filipino people, attempting to kill the sovereignty of this nation at ibenta ang ating kalayaan. And I will explore this issue in a while. These public agencies and public servants abusing their authority must be held accountable under the Committee on Public Accounts headed by Chairman Caraps Paduano. Tama lang po ang approach ng Kongreso sa pangunguna ni Speaker Martin Romualdez. Malalim na investigasyon sa organized crime under my committee. Illegal drugs under the Committee of Dangerous Drugs. Mga violation sa karapatang pantao, Pilipino man o banyaga sa Committee on Human Rights at public accountability ng mga tao sa gobyerno na inabuso ang kapangyarihan na pinagkaloob sa kanila ng mamamayan na nasa ilalim ng Committee on Public Accounts. Last Monday, it was moved by Senior Deputy Speaker Dong Gonzales that these four committees should start a joint meeting to expedite the interconnection of different issues and thereafter recommending prosecution for those perpetrators. Sa lahat ng apat na issue ito, iisa lamang ang common denominator. Chinese. Patutunayan natin, unang issue, Pidea piles drugs, drug wraps versus importers of Shabu in magnetic lifters. Noong August 29, 2018, 335 kilos of Shabu worth billion of pesos ang mga nahuling mga taga-China, Chan Yi Hua, Shang Quan. Noong April 16, 2024, sa pagpapatuloy ng operasyon ng Pidea, nahulian ang 1.8 tons of Shabu worth $230 million. Sa Zambales, 500 kilograms of Shabu nahuli, apat na Chinese nationals, si Gao Mao Xu, si Hong Han She, si Editan at si Su Yu Ha, na lahat taga Fujian, China. Yung 14K Hong Kong Triad at si Sun Yi O, pinakamalaking powerful drug trafficking organization in the global illegal drug market. Sila ang pinakamalaking supplier na shabu sa Pilipinas at sinabi nila na ang Pilipinas ang pinakadabes sa market at transshipment at point ng shabu dito sa ating pong rehiyon. Sa Cavite, 2 Chinese men ang napatay at 2 bilyong shabu ang nakuha ng Pidea. Ito ang mga droga na apprehended were all brought here by Chinese. Ang nahuli ay mga Chinese. Ang gumawa ay Chinese. Ang tanong dito is bakit nila pinupuno ng droga ang bansang Pilipinas? But I would like to show and share to you briefly the opium wars of China with Great Britain. The first opium war was in 1841. Ang emperor nila during that time ay si Dang Guang. Dahil during that time, ang Western, particularly ang Great Britain, di sila makapag-trade sa China dahil ayaw ng emperor. Kaya ang ginawa ng British, they plotted China with drugs, leading to widespread addiction na nagdulot ng pagkakagulo, pagpapatayan, social unrest, and ang economic impact sa Chinese government. At ito ang naghudyat ng unang digmaan ng dalawang bansa. At dahil dito, this forced China na ibigay ang Hong Kong for 100 years sa Britanya. Ang ikalawang digmaan naman po ng opium war ng China with Britain ay noong 1856. Yung pagkakahuli ng isang ship ng Britain called Arrow by the Chinese authorities. Ito ang ginamit ng British to start another opium war. Nagsama-sama na dito ang Great Britain, France, and other Western forces that lead to the defeat of China. At dahil dito, na-capture ang Beijing in 1860. Natapos ang digmaan na ito with the signing of the Treaty of Tientsin in 1858 and the Treaty of Beijing in 1860. Ang mga treaty na ito ay expanding yung control ng Western sa China ports, sa markets, at gawing legal ang opium o drug trade. Ganun din po ba ang ginagawa ng China sa atin with our own version of war on drugs? Di po ba ang daming mga droga naggaling sa China? Kailan po ba ito nagsimula? Di po ba halos lahat ng nagpapasok ng droga sa ating bayan ay Chinese according sa ating mga reports ng Pidea? Sino ang nagpapasok sa kanila? Yan po ay katanungang iiwan ko sa inyo panandalian, pero maliwanag pa sa sikat ng araw na ang issue ng droga ang evolve ang ating common denominator, mga Chinese. Pangalawa, Sa isyu ng paglabag sa karapatang pantao, sa hearing po ng Committee on Human Rights, marami po ang established na namatay sa war on drugs. Ang PNP report, lumalabas, 7,640. Sa Presidential Communication Office, inilabas nila na 20,000 ang report ng PCO na umabot noong taong 2017. These deaths includes human rights abuses that was a product of war on drugs that was carried out by the illegal drugs brought by the Chinese national in cahoots with bribe Filipinos appointed and elected official of the government. Sila ang makabagong makapili. At dito naman sa ating investigasyon sa POGO, nakita natin na ang perpetrators ng mga organized crime, tortures, killings, kidnappings, and so on, and so on, and so on. Again, Chinese. Sa issue naman po ng korporasyon, ng pag-aari ng mga Chinese, thousands of hectares of land na pag-aari ng mga korporasyon na ang mga incorporators ay mga Chinese, yung Empire 99 Corporation, 300 titles na established po to sa Committee ng Public Accounts ni Chairman Caraps Paduano and all the incorporators are Chinese. Ang mga politiko naman na pretending to be Filipinos but supported by a company owned by China or affiliated with China. Naalala niyo po ba yung mga tarpulin na ganito na kung saan gagawin tayong probinsya ng China? This is a mind setting. This is mind conditioning. Ilan pa kaya ang alis go sa ating mga elected officials? Ilan pa kaya sa kanila o sa amin o sa atin dito ang supported directly or indirectly by the wide comprehensive mobilization of their different elements to perpetrate their intention to control our nation and invade us without firing a single bullet. Pati na ang iniimbestigahan natin dito. Yung SMNI was investigated by Congress. It was mentioned by Napoda City Representative Toby Chanco noong December 11 na karang taon that SMNI is affiliated with CGTN, China Global TV Network. Meron silang partnership which was used to push the China's agenda. Pansinin po natin yan, mga kababayan, and even ang NGCP, ang National Grid Corporation. Siyang nagsusupply ng kuryente sa buong Pilipinas, sila ang bumubuhay sa ating ekonomiya dahil sila nagdadala nito sa ating mga pabrika, sa ating mga tahanan, sa paaralan, sa ating gobyerno, sa ating military, sa ating PNP, lahat ng sakay ng gobyerno, sila ang nag-aalaga ng seguridad ng ating kuryente. Ang 40% nito ay pag-aari ng State Grid Corporation of China. 60% kay Henry C. and Robert Coyuto. Tama si Speaker Martin Romualdez. We need to buy back through the Sovereign Wealth Fund yung Maharlika Investment Corporation na mabili natin kahit isa man lang board seat sa NGCP. Dahil tayo na lamang sa buong mundo na ang national grid or our transmission line is owned by a private company, owned by a foreigner, owned by a country who wants to control us and invade us silently. Di ba yung 9-meter dash line na sinakop na nila ang ating buong, ang buo nating karagatan ay gusto na nilang kunin? Gumising na po tayo, mga kababayan. As reported and discussed in the Committee on Transportation headed by Chairman Romy Acop, ang Coast Guard, 36 Coast Guards, Chinese, mga general, mga koronel. Ang first line of defense natin, depend natin, yung ating pong coastline, yung ating karagatan, sila nagdedepensa. Pero meron po tayong mga general na mga Chinese, meron tayong mga koronel na mga coast guards. They penetrated us. Our first line of defense was penetrated already. And even General Gaban told us and asked for an executive session during that time. Dahil sinasabi, nababayaran ang posisyon sa Coast Guard. Pera din ang umiiral, nagkabayaran dito, the power of bribery were all around us, that Filipinos, especially elected and appointed officials, accepted the bribe without really knowing that they were already selling our sovereignty and our territory. Even our Philippine Statistics Authority, the requirement for the late registration was relaxed. Thereby, the easy access for birth certificate for Chinese was done without haste. The service provider of PSA is Unisys with link with the Chinese corporation Lenovo. Madaling makakuha ng Philippine passport dahil madali na ang pagkuha ng birth certificate. Thousands of Chinese were issued Filipino passport, even our students' visa, issued by different agencies and special resident visa and the retirement visa and also yung AEP ng DOLE. 180,000 were issued to POGOS employees were all used to mobilize their Chinese people to penetrate us, to penetrate our wealth, our rights, and our nation. Yung mga uniforme na nakita sa PORAC na may People's Liberation Army seal is an indication that Chinese military people are running the show in these facilities. Sinisinumula na po tayo ng kanilang operasyon using our own resources. Sa madaling salita, kinigisa tayo sa sarili nating mantika. Ang lahat na nangyayaring ito na may kinalaman ang mga Chinese ay isang bagay na di natin dapat isawalang bahala. Mahal natin yung mga Chino na pinapanganak at lumaki, nagkaisip, namuhay, na tunay na isang Pilipino. Sila man po ay hindi dugong Pilipino, subalit sila naman po ay pinili na maging Pilipino sa isip, sa salita, at sa gawa. Tama ang Pangulo ng ating bansa, Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos. The pivotal decision of the President turning not away from China but in the middle and put the primary interest of this nation first deserves high respect and accolade. Salute! We may have been involved to these different elements of silent invasion without us knowing it. Pero ngayong alam na po natin, tama na, tigilan na po natin to. This is not about money anymore. Not about power too. But this is about our freedom. Kailan tayo kikilos at magkakaisa kung tayo ay nasakop na tulad ng ginawa ng Britanya sa kanila. Dumami ang droga, dumami ang patayan, nagkagulo, di nagkakaisa, at sa gitna ng kanilang kaguluhan, sila ay sinakop ng Britanya. Matuto na sana tayo sa kasaysayan. Even our own history, 300 taon tayong sinakop ng Kastila, sinakop tayo ng Hapon, sinakop tayo ng Amerikano. At matapos nila tayong masakop, saka lang tayo nagkaisa at lumaban. Never again. Let's be united and maintain our freedom. Maraming salamat at naway gabayan tayo ng Ama na lumikha ng langit at lupa.
The chair recognize Congresswoman Jinky Luistro. Go ahead, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I wish to address my question to Attorney Harry Roque. With all due respect, Attorney, Mr. Chair, this is a common knowledge that Attorney Harry Roque worked as the spokesperson for former President Rodrigo Roa Duterte. Does our resource speaker confirm this?
Yes, Madam Chair. Mr. Chair.
And Mr. Chair, can we please direct the resource speaker to describe ano po ba ang trabaho ng isang resource speaker ng presidente?
As spokesperson, I was addressing the Malacañang Press Corps 3 times a week. I was preparing press releases on behalf of the president, and I was answering queries from the media on behalf of the president.
And will the resource speaker agree if I would say that a spokesperson position is a position of trust and confidence?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
And by position of trust and confidence, it means that the president is giving you his full trust and confidence in all matters that might be within or even relevant to the discharge of your function as presidential spokesperson. Does the resource speaker agree?
Mr. Chairman, subject to regular consultations with the president.
And for the information of the committee, by the position of trust and confidence, it means that the moment the president lost the trust and confidence to the person, he can anytime terminate this official.
I confirm that, Mr. Chairman. I was appointed to a position with the rank of cabinet member.
I understand as well that Attorney Roque is one of the seasoned lawyers, as a matter of fact, internationally. Can you please enlighten us on your background as a lawyer?
I have been teaching international law in UP as well as in American University and National University of Singapore, total of more than 20 years already until now. And I was past president of the Asian Society of International Law. I'm also a member of the List Council of the International Criminal Court.
And having earned that reputation in the legal circle, Mr. Chair, and being the presidential spokesperson as well, I would assume that if ever there will be erroneous decisions on the part of the president, Attorney Harry Roque will be calling the attention and correcting or perhaps stopping the president from pursuing such erroneous action. Will the resource speaker agree to this?
I do not think I had that function. I could only speak for the president. I could not actually countermand him. I could not correct him. He is my principal.
But considering, Mr. Chair, that he is a lawyer and a spokesperson as well, pagka ho ba may maling desisyon ang presidente, will you not volunteer your legal expertise to correct the president?
Unless I am asked for my opinion, Mr. Chair, I will not volunteer, Your Honor.
Mr. Chair, I wish to invite the attention of Attorney Harry Roque to PD 1869. This is described as the Charter of PAGCOR. And as a matter of fact, it defines what illegal gambling is. I also wish to invite his attention to Republic Act No. 9487, which extends the franchise of PAGCOR to another 25 years. Again, it defines what illegal gambling is. Ultimately, Mr. Chair, I wish to invite the attention of Attorney Roque to Executive Order No. 13. And I wish to state for the record, Mr. Chair, that for the very first time, the term online gaming was mentioned in Executive Order No. 13. This is something which is not mentioned, which is not provided in PD 1869 as well as in RA 9487. May I ask the resource speaker, when the president issued Executive Order No. 13, don't you think he legislated?
I am unable to make an opinion because when I was a spokesperson, legal matters such as these are directed to the Presidential Legal Counsel or to the Office of the Solicitor General or to the Legal Office of the President under the Executive Secretary.
Mr. Chair, this representation wishes to solicit the opinion of a legal expert, our resource speaker, Attorney Harry Roque. I am sure that with the number of hearings he went through already, he has come across Executive Order Number 13. This is the presidential issuance during the time of former President Rodrigo Roa Duterte, mentioning the term online gaming for the very first time. The term that was never mentioned in PD 1869 and even in RA 9487. I hope we can be enlightened by the legal expertise of our resource speaker. When the President issued EO Number 13, providing for the term online gaming for the very first time, don't you think, Attorney Roque, that the President legislated?
Again, Your Honor, I am unable to answer because that is not within my expertise. I have mentioned that my expertise is in the field of public international law, having taught and practiced that. And I am sorry because I am not very familiar with Executive Order Number 13. In fact, my only knowledge of Executive Order Number 13 was in the last hearing when former Chair Domingo said that President Duterte regulated online gambling, no? Through Executive Order Number 13. But I am unable to give an opinion now, not being thoroughly familiar with the EO as well as the underpinnings behind the issuance of Executive Order Number 13. I'm so sorry, Your Honor, it's not within my field of expertise.
With all due respect to our resource speaker, Mr. Chair, I find it strange na sa dami po ng hearing na ina-attendan niya, both in the Senate and in the Congress, all pertaining to BOGOs, he have not come across EO Number 13, from which the BOGOs or the online gaming started. But I'm sure, for the next concern that I wish to raise, our resource speaker is very much familiar with, because this is fundamental in the study of law. There is in law the principle of separation of powers. And I wish to share the case of Belgica versus Ochoa, GR number 208566, November 19, 2013, on the constitutionality of the Priority Development Assistance Fund. For the information of the Filipino people, I wish to read the principle of separation of powers. Refers to the constitutional demarcation of the three fundamental powers of the government. In the celebrated words of Justice Laurel Inangara versus Electoral Commission, it means that the Constitution has blocked out, with deft strokes and in bold lines, allotment of power to the executive, the legislative, and the judicial departments of the government. To the legislative branch of the government, through Congress, belongs the power to make laws. To the executive branch of the government, through the president, belongs the power to enforce laws. To the judicial branch of government, through the court, belongs the power to interpret laws. I wish to go back to Attorney Roque. Attorney Roque, don't you think that the president encroached upon the power of the Congress when he issued Executive Order Number 13 providing for online?
Well, Mr. Chair, first and foremost, I argued that case of Belica. I was lawyer in the Supreme Court for Mr. Belica, and I confirmed the principle of separation of powers. However, as I said, although it is not my expertise, I will give my opinion, my candid opinion. And that is, under our scheme of things, executive issuances, legislative enactments are all presumed to be constitutional unless proven otherwise. So the status of Executive Order Number 13, unless challenged in court, is that it is presumed to be constitutional. Executive orders being in the nature of implementing existing legislation, Your Honor.
Mr. Chair, there's a principle in law. When the law does not provide, we should not provide. When the law does not include, we should not include. If the substantive law creating PAGCOR does not provide for online gaming, then no executive issuances should provide for online gaming. Let us all be reminded by the Litan legal maxim, inclusio unius est exclusio alterius. Kung wala naman pong sinabi dun sa substantive law, then the procedural law should not provide. Let us be reminded that the procedural law should always yield in favor of the substantive law. Mr. Chair, I wish to invite the attention of the committee to Executive Order Number 13, the presidential issuance which provides for the very first time for the term online gaming, the term that was never mentioned in the legislation that was passed by Congress. In the 8 whereas clause, it says, clarifying the extent of authority of gambling regulators, particularly with regards to online gaming. And then we have Section 3, clarification on online gambling, which technically defines what online gambling is. And then under Section 4, Mr. Chair, it emphasizes the oversight function of the Office of the President over all forms of gaming, and that includes online gaming. I humbly submit, Mr. Chair, that EO number 13 brings online gambling into life. And I do not understand, Mr. Chair, why this should circumvent the law that was passed by Congress creating the PAGCOR and providing the authorities to regulate all the gaming and gambling activities. Once again, Mr. Chair, I wish to raise the reason why the principle of separation of powers is very important. The principle of separation of powers and its concepts of autonomy and independence stem from the notion that the powers of the government must be divided to avoid concentration of these powers in any one branch. The division, it is hoped, would avoid any single branch from lording its power over the other branches or the citizenry. To achieve this purpose, the divided power must be wielded by co-equal branches of government that are equally capable of independent action in exercising their respective mandates. Lack of independence would result in the inability of one branch of government to check the arbitrary or self-interest assertions of another or others. To wind up, Mr. Chair, I wish to state for the record that when the President issued Executive Order Number 13, it is the humble submission of this representation. He legislated, he amended, he repealed the law. An act which violates the fundamental principle of separation of power. The executive should not encroach upon the power to legislate that belongs exclusively to the Congress. Thank you, Mr. Chair.